गुड इवनिंग, वेलकम इवेंट इंटरनेशनल पीयर रिव्यू वर्कशॉप 2020 पावर्ड बाय इनोवेटिव पब्लिकेशन. इन दिस वी आर टॉकिंग ऑल अबाउट पीयर रिव्यू. इफ यू हैव एनी डिफिकल्टीज रिगार्डिंग द ऑडियो एंड वीडियो ऑफ दिस वेबिनार देन प्लीज लेट अस नो थ्रू द कमेंट बॉक्स. वी विल हेल्प यू. प्लीज चेक योर ऑडियो वीडियो सेटिंग्स बिफोर वी स्टार्ट. This program comprises four sessions, each of 80 minutes on 19, 20, 26, 27, that is last two weekends of September 2020, respectively. Every session is subdivided into four parts: introduction, presentation by key speaker, question answer session, the topic covered in today's session is quantitative and qualitative analysis of peer review, models and theory of peer review, principal functions and management of different peer review models, then incentive, motivation and recognition in peer review. The highlight of workshop is hands-on experience of peer review. Please go through www.innopub.org for webinar article review process. We will explain you it in a later slide. And download hands-on, review any one article and upload it latest by 24 September. Best review article selected by panel of senior editor reviewers will be awarded. It's a protocol writing. Quiz competition is held on 27 September. Gift and rewards are distributed. Expert opinion from any male is considered for the inclusion in last session. So you all are invited to share your expert opinion. For the assignment, peer review assignment, the two assignments are there. One is following the footsteps, reviewing by protocol. The most valuable and accurate content from will be awarded. And peer review assignment two, that is name of comment and crisp but not brisk. The detail for this assignment should be explained by Dr. Ketki in after her presentation. So you are familiar with this flyer actually. These all are the leading researcher, the gems of research. They are presenting you this peer review details. So we will start our introduction session from Innovative Publication. So Innovative Publication is a publisher in medical, dental, pharmacy, nursing and allied sciences. Innovative publishes high quality peer reviewed open access article in all specialties. Here are some reasons to publish with Innovative and experience our exceptional services. To know more, please visit www.ipinnovative.com and submit your manuscript at www.innopub.org. So, introduction to our key speakers today. Dr. Lalit Gupta is MBBS, DAD, NB, Anesthesia, MNAMS, Associate Professor in Anesthesiology and Intensive Care in Dr. Maulana Azad Medical College and Associate Hospital, New Delhi. He had more than 80 publications in esteemed national and international journal, and he is a reviewer and associate editor and editor-in-chief for more than 60 national and international journals. He had authored chapter in many books, both at international and national level. He is a foundation member of Anesthesia and Critical Care Foundation Society. He is a member of advisory board for International Conference on Technology and Education, member of National Advisory Board, Innovative Education and Scientific Research Foundation. And recently, he is a Indian flag bearer in a BRIC roundtable event on COVID. Research interest is intensive care, remote area anesthesia management, difficulty of way, onco anesthesia, pain medicine, and palliative care. Now, welcome Dr. Lalit. Dr. Ketki ma'am, Dr. Ketki P. Kalele is a BDS, MDS and a scientific writer. She is assistant professor in Department of Oral and Maxillofacial Pathology and Microbiology, Amravati, Maharashtra. She is editor-in-chief जनरल ऑफ ओरल मेडिसिन, ओरल सर्जरी, ओरल पैथोलॉजी एंड ओरल रेडियोलॉजी, डायरेक्टर ऑफ डेंथ ऑफ फेस, 20 नेशनल इंटरनेशनल पब्लिकेशन शी इंडेक्स, शी पब्लिश इन इंडेक्स जनरल इन क्रेडिट टिल डेट. शी ऑथर्ड टू बुक्स, की स्पीकर फॉर कैंसर कॉन्फ्रेंसेस इन स्पेन एंड यूए. शी सर्व्स ऑन रिव्यूअर्स एंड एडिटोरियल बोर्ड ऑफ वेरियस जर्नल of her specialty, National Advisory Board Member for IESRF, and the third speaker is Mr. Rakesh Kumar Pandit, is a Production Director, IP Innovative Publications Private Limited, Director and Co-Founder Member of Innovative Group, Editor-in-Chief for Journal of Management and Research Analysis, 20 plus year experience in publishing field, published many articles, editorial and reviewer of many journals, honored by honorary Rosalind member for London General Film, developing and executing the company's strategies for production and marketing, paper presentation and poster presentation in publishing program AFMC Pune and AOA Jodhpur, member of NISO Federation of Publisher Association India, GOC, SAVI, holding many positions in societies for scholarly welfare. His interest is exploring in research publication, research welfare, scholar research disseminations. If you have any question during the presentation and after the presentation, you just ask in the bottom of your screen, a question answer box is there. We will try to answer as many as unique question as we can. If somehow we could not answer the question due to time constraint, then you will you can email us your question at info@ipinnovative.com. We will try to answer it all. Thank you. Now I would like to request Dr. Lalit to share his presentation.
Okay. Good evening, everyone. Hello. This evening, warm welcome to all of you. This conference is very much for peer reviews, the budding peer reviewers who think they can write the papers and they can help us in publishing the best papers around. So what I am going to discuss with you is about the peer review. What is the analysis about them and how it helps? So let's start. The topic for today is quantitative and qualitative analysis of peer review. What is peer review and how it helps in the budding reviewers, authors, and the well-established names to decide a paper is accepted or not accepted? Okay, we will go through it through a lots of things. We will discuss. I will tell you how to evaluate a paper. What are the considerations which we usually give while reviewing a paper? How to accept? How to reject? And how to? I will analyze both the type of the paper, the quantitative as well as the qualitative. Like there is a peak pressures on the authors. They have to publish. Yes. And why they have to publish is because there are the two things. They have to publish the articles because they have to progress in the MCA as per the guidelines. They want to show the peer pressure from their students, their colleagues. They have to publish their thesis. Similarly, there is a peak pressures on the reviewers. Like the editorial board decides when the paper comes, if it has to be accepted, rejected, and what should it happens. Now, as you know, what is it, how it works, and how should it evolve? There are the three major questions which one should be able to answer. And most scientists regard the new streamlined peer review process as quite an improvement over the previous ones. So how it works and what is it? If you go by the definitions, peer review, also known as the referring, is the process of subjecting an author's scholarly work, research or ideas to the scrutiny of others who are the expert in the same field. That is, if you are publishing a paper in biochemistry, the person who is reviewing your paper should be from the biochemistry. If it is from anesthesia, it should be from the anesthesia. In the case of the peer-reviewed journals, they are usually academic and scientific periodicals. Peer review generally refers to the evaluation of the articles prior to the publication by experts who are not the part of the editorial staffs. And this definition is given by the International Committee of Medical Journal Editors, which is the uniform that the expert should not be part of the editorial staff while reviewing a paper. Coming to the history, history is very interesting about the peer review. You know, it is dated back to the 17th century when the scholarly works were examined for any hints of heresy, that is any plagiarism. And it is was by the Inquisition of the Holy Roman and Catholic Church. So this is the most authentic proof that it is usually exist during the 17th century. However, with the print media, the first recorded academic peer review process was at the Royal Society in 1665 by the founding editor of Philosophical Transactions of the Royal Society, Henry Oldenburg, sir. Soon it was followed by the earliest name in the publication, Medical Essays and Observations. They published the Royal Society of Edinburgh in 1731. And since then, there is no go back for the peer review. Coming to the modern peer review system, despite this early start in many scientific journals, the editorials only have to say whether an article should be published or not until there was the World War II. But then science and the journals of the American Medical Association, and they were not in the favor of doing it during the World War II even till 1940. And then the Lancet, the most authentic name in the name of the publication, they did not implement peer review till 1976. So if you see, it is the last 3 and 4 decades which has developed a peer review system because of the availability of the print media, that is the photocopying, where the sending of the articles has become so easy that people can say. And since after that, the email system, the Google has made the things so easier that the things can be peer reviewed. And now it has become the golden standard in evaluation of everything from the scholarly publication to the grants to the tenure decision. That's why peer review is needed. It has been elevated to a principle, a unifying principle for a remarkably fragmented field. That is, it is the only thing which is unified, which is the standard in this type of the field where lots of things coming day by day and lots of publications happen. So who are the various parties who are involved in the act of publishing? If you see, from the society, there is an author who arises. He sends it to the editor. Editor then says, okay, let me send it to a reviewer. And reviewer finally, yes or no, send back to the editor. And then it becomes published paper or rejected paper. So how it happens? We will go through it. What peer reviewer wants? If you ask me, a lay person who is new, there is some well-known personalities who says, I confess I am a peer reviewer and I don't really know what I am doing. Peer review is a common part of the job of early career researchers, and yet we receive very little training on how to peer review. That is, remember the word very little training. People are not trained how to peer review a paper, and it was how exactly do I do that. Similarly, I think there should be a system where a PhD students have to review at least 3 papers during the training. And I think this is the thing that MCI should also think over, that there should be a mechanism. The supervisor should write a paper and the student should write their reviews so that the improvement feedback can be given in the next review. And should there be training? Yes, there should be training. And finally, if we want to improve the peer review, we need to invest in training. That is why this workshop exists. With peer review remaining so central to the research process, despite its flaws, understanding the motivation to publish and to review another academic work is crucial. Addressing what training is needed is even more important. And this is what this workshop is for. What makes this course unique? Yeah, course features include what we are going to discuss in the next 4 sessions, 4 days, video, infographics, and other interactive elements. Active discussion form, yes, where we are discussing quizzes. There will be mock peer review exercises where you will be rewarded and advices and deep insight from profiling experienced peer reviewers. So it is a complete, comprehensive, interactive training course for the peer reviewers. Now coming a brief review, what is the peer review, how they exist, internal versus external. Internal review is conducted by the editorial staff where he decides where a paper should be sent, or if he think a paper is not appropriate, he can reject for the very first stage. External review, which is done by the experts, the people in the field, and it can be again blind and open, where in the blind peer review, submitted manuscripts are sent outside the journals, publishing or sponsoring organization for review by external reviewers, whose identifications are always hidden. While in the open review system, the identity is disclosed. Often authors are encouraged to suggest the possible reviewers. But if the reviewers are same to be same or not, it is decided by the journals or the editor. What are the problems with their peer review? You won't believe that famous papers were published who did not get the peer review. If you remember the weak and electromagnetic interactions, the paper by the Abdul Salam in 1968, it led to a Nobel Prize. It was never peer reviewed. Similarly, the famous paper of Annals Mirabilis by the Albert Einstein in 1905. Issue of the Annals of Physics were only reviewed by the editor because at that time peer review didn't exist. However, the famous papers who were passed by the peer review later proved to be fraudulent. I should not say the name, but 1998 to 2001, there were the 15 paper series published by a single author, which was later found to be fraudulent. However, they were all peer reviewed and they were all passed in the initial stages. Similarly, in 1999 to 2002, papers were published in the Theoretical Physics, believed by many to be the Jagrin nonsense later on. And there were again the paper who were rejected and later turned out to be the seminal work, the masterpiece, and still exist in the world. You must remember the famous Krebs cycle in the biochemistry, which you must have read. It was rejected as saying it is insufficient importance, but eventually published in the Dutch journal Enzymology, and now it grabbed the 1953 Nobel Prize. And now you can think of the importance of peer review. So what is the responsibility of a peer reviewer? Filtering out incorrect, inadequate and fraudulent work, improving the accuracy of the clarity of the work, helping the journal deal with the high volumes, helping the journal deal with the multiple publication. And what is the work where that should not be do the peer review? They should not poke their nose. Role of the editor is deciding whether a paper should be accepted or rejected. Peer reviewer should only give their suggestions or the comments. Improving the spelling and grammar, they should not point out there is a punctuation mistake. It is the role of the copy editor. Improving in the study design, they must suggest to the author only. And dissemination of the reviewed paper, it should not be till the paper is officially in the print. They can give the preprint. They can publish, they can use, they can tell about that. So if you coming the flowchart which I have made for you, the author decides where to submit the paper. The editorial staff decide where the article should be appraised. It should be rejected or should be sent somewhere else, or it should be in the peer review system. Once it comes in the peer review system, there always exists a grading, where grading is either of two types. Scoring is given 1 to 10, that is the quantitative, which is our point of discussion today. Or qualitative, that is which is the comments given by the authors regarding the paper. So either the paper is published, accept, reject or send elsewhere. So what we are going to discuss is the quantitative as well as the qualitative grading and analysis, how peer review system works. Okay, this is an example. This I will be discussing the qualitative type of peer review. Here in this form, if you can see, there the article says abstract, the appropriate study methods, yes and no, when the most of the answers are given. Similarly, if there is a problem, the authors only suggest publish without rejection, with addition, without subtraction, with a major revision, or encourage and rewrite. So comments and suggestions are written and it is sent. While there is a quantitative type of peer review, where the revision comments are sent, revision comments as a compulsory, minor and major comments, and there is a grading, like 9 to 10 accepted, 8 to 9 minor revision, 7 to 8 major revision, or 1 to 3 paper is rejected. The marks are given and the editorial decides on the basis of the mark whether the paper should be accepted or rejected. That is type of the quantitative which we are going to discuss in future slides. So there are tools which are used to assess the quality of a peer review report. There is a methodological system in review published in the BMC name methodology, and this will be discussing in the later chapters, in the later discussion. However, if you see, there is a validity tool which defines peer review report quality in biomedical research. Yes, it will allow the researchers to have a structured instrument to evaluate the impact of interventions at improving the peer review in well-performed trials. Such a tools could also be regularly used by editors to evaluate the tools, how it works is the point of discussion today. Lot of the tools have been derived, both the qualitative as well as the quantitative, because they are different from face-to-face reviewing and using the pen and paper mark. And there is a summary if I have made for you. This will be told you later on in the lectures. But since 1995 to 2005, there have been a lot of improvements in the tools. We decide whether what should be the type of peer review system. It should be qualitative, quantitative, or how it should work. And it should difference between the various type of reviews which are conducted. So what we are going to discuss is quantitative as well as qualitative analysis. From the source, from the analysis, and who can look for them. This is our point of discussion now. There is a famous paper presented by the quantitative analysis of the peer review. Now, if you see, the paper was highlighted there is a significant difference on the randomness in the analyzed review process. There is a disagreement among the reviewers about a paper because of the ranking of the review process, impact on the papers, citations, and there is a marks given high and low by the different reviewers. And why it happens, it is the point of concern. and simply unbiasing. Unbiasing cannot be said, it is also exists in these papers like other systems. So what decides whether a paper is good, how the review should be done? It is the triad: quality, fairness and efficiency, which decides whether a quality, if you go with quantitative paper, how should be reviewed. Quality related to the final result, a review pressure process ensure quality is the best contributions as chosen. Fairness, if acceptance of the contribution does not depend on the particular set of reviewers, yes, the paper is very fair and the quantitative analysis is very good. Efficiency, it depends on the statistical accuracy of the reviewer results, which I am going to discuss with you. So as I told you, there is a triad of quality, fairness and efficiency. While quality refers to the disagreement between the author, divergence and the robustness of the reviewers, while fairness means unbiased and biased, and efficiency, effort versus quality and effort versus invariant alternatives which are existing during the review process. Coming to the quality metrics, if we had an objective way to measure the quality of each contribution, we could measure the quality of each peer review process and identify which processes are more likely to be of high quality. However, quality is subjective and there are no objective or widely accepted ways to measure it. So you cannot decide the quality of a paper just by reviewing it. Nevertheless, we think it is possible to define metrics that approximate indicates the quality. That is, their indicator. And robustness and biases. If these all points are taken, then the quality of the paper which are to be going to accepted or rejected can be decided. So if you go through this matrix, which is statistical, the probability of accepting a paper is directly proportional to the marks given. On a scale of the 10, if the 10 is the mark, it is 0.02. That is, it is the highest probability that a paper will be accepted. So we were on the quality. The quality is the high disagreement value, which means in some way the judgment of the involved peers is not sufficient, or based on the disagreement value, if the three reviewers are enough to judge a contribution, or if more reviewers are needed in order to ensure the quality of the process. Coming to the fairness, it is quality lessons learned. Quality lessons are the measurement of the disagreement of a reviewer is a useful metric to the check and monitor the degree of the process of randomness. Having a high disagreement value means in some way that the judgment of the involved peers is not sufficient to state the value. Based on the disagreement values, if three reviewers are enough to judge a contribution or if reviewers are needed in order to ensure the quality of process. Coming to the fairness means there are the biases. The biases can be, most significant biases are rating bias, namely where the reviewers are positively or negatively biased, that is they consistently give higher marks than their colleagues who are reviewing the same proposal, or it's sometimes the bad luck of being assigned to one such a tough reviewer, the chance of acceptance is decreased. Okay, so potential biases. What are the potential biases? They are the rating biases. Reviewers are biased if they are consistently give higher or the lower marks, or colleagues who are reviewing the same paper. It also believes the affiliation bias, that is the university where the paper is sent, the topic, it can be of your interest, can be of disinterest, the country bias, as well as the gender bias. So male and female which always exist, and it to decrease this type of bias, there is a quality score which is given. The score is the sum of the scores Am I audible? Yeah. Okay, fine. Sum of the scores, score obtained by summing all the scores of each item present in a scale, mean of the scores, single scores, summary scores, as well as the summary, that is the total scores which are derived by the...
You are audible, but your voice is cracking, sir. And your screen is again discontinued, shared.
Okay, I have changed the connection. I think it will go now.
Okay, sir. You will try.
Okay, let me try again. Mm-hmm. Okay, is it audible now?
Yes.
Yeah, fine. So, what we were discussing were the scoring systems. Scoring systems are the exceptional, very good, good, below average and unacceptable. While the partially defined are poor, acceptable, reliable and excellent. while there is a poor fair, there is an undefined type of the scoring system. But poor means doesn't follow the reviewer guidelines. Acceptable comments are somehow helpful, reliable, and very excellent type of system is always exist. So this is the type of the quantitative as well as the qualitative type of where both the things are seen. It can be compulsory, minor, optional, or scores are given according to these type of scoring. Now coming to the qualitative assessment of the peer review process, where there is a conclusion is drawn in the terms of the particular comments which the authors usually the reviewers gives to the authors. And these types of the qualitative, these are the things on which the editor decide whether the paper should be accepted or rejected. And if you go, there are the characteristic of the reviewer comments, which is the most important, strength and the weakness, the presentation and organization, and last, structure, reviewers, and timeless interpretations. So what are the quality components of the peer review? If you go, you will see there that did the reviewer give appropriate attention, important of the question, the originality of the paper, how authors interpret the result, that is the relevance, originality, and the interpretation of the results. And similarly, the explanation and the examples are the strength and the weakness of the study, include identify the study strength, weakness in the study method, that is the statistical methods, confidence interval, p-values, overall fit or not, that I told you, the low higher the point p-value, the more will be the chances of the acceptance of the paper. Presentation and organization of the manuscript, how it is written, the figures are tables are in the appropriate places. The structure of the reviewer comment, that is the concise, well-organized comments are there, items inquiring if the reviewers has made the peer review report organized and structured comments are there. And finally, the reviewer comment, that is the clarity of the issue, the constructiveness where the reviewer comments are given, details, that is the detail of the commentary, the balanced of fairness, knowledgeability, the knowledge of the manuscript area is tested, and the tone, overall tone of the reviewer's remark is very much important. So timeline of the review, if it is been reviewed in the proper time, that the punctuality of the review, that is if we given the 2 weeks time, it is done in the 2 weeks, the usefulness of the reviewer report, that is decision about the acceptance or the revision of the manuscript is taken, and the manuscript improvement, that is if the reviewers have decided and is given the appropriate time to the authors to review their proper, means they have given the review ads to the author for improving their works by writing, whether the reviewer makes a good judgment regarding acceptance or the submission plays no role here whatsoever. So if you going back to the slides, I will show the main important part is the relevance, followed by the originality and the interpretation of the study result. If these three parts have been made properly by the author, it means the paper will be accepted and there will be no point that the paper will not be accepted or it will be rejected directly. While the other thing, strength and the weakness of the study, that is all the author's criteria, general methodology, statistical methods, presentation and organization are equally important because they show how the authors know how to write a paper and what are the various things, the various criteria which the authors have tried and has been properly explained. And finally, the comments. So clarity, constructiveness, they all becomes the sub-secondary things once the paper has been fully explained by the reviewers or the authors. So quality components coming, timeline, I told you 2 weeks minimum or maximum, and manuscript improvement. If the author follow the things, the paper is sent back to the reviewers where it is reviewed again. And it is has been seen the many times the authors done the all the changes as per the reviewers and the paper is accepted. So finally, what are the suggestions for improvement of the qualitative review service? Standardization and creation of the manuscript review protocols, recruiting peer reviewers in the same fields addressed in the manuscript, recognizing and treating peer review as a professional, editorial review of the reviewer quality with feedback on the performance, blending of the reviewers, some basic criteria may be important for all the general reviewers, and along with the same lines, rigid adherence and criteria of checkbox, especially for an inexperienced reviewer, risk the reviewer missing the forest for the trees. And mind me one thing, the standard goal line is the editors may find the narrative detail review in proposed submitted by the reviewers to be the more valuable than a quantitative scoring. That is, it is the comments of the reviewers which is given, as I told you, for the 9 points on the basis of the review process that the editors find and they accept or reject the paper. So once the authors have the both the quantitative and qualitative type of the review, how they are going to write a final review report. What is, and it is the most important part of a reviewer. The report should be clear, concise, and accurate. Although the primary purpose is to advise the editor, comments to the authors frequently are of the value in guiding revision of the paper for the same or a different journal and in suggesting ways to improve the project by the inclusion or addition data. Comments to the author may be very brief, especially in the case of an excellent, well-prepared paper, and there may be extensive if the reviewer feels the paper has value for observation but requires further revision to present the finding effectively. So, what makes a good reviewer? I am always asked what is a good reviewer, and I always say the reviewer is one which is less than 40 years. Why? Because the less than 40 years is very enthusiastic one. He always goes for the new things. While the senior people have a lot of things to do, they are in the research process and they have the little time for the review. From the top academic institution, yes, it is very important. And the person who is well known to the editor because he knows his field of interest, he knows his strength, he knows he can review the paper much better than others. And blinded to the intent identity of the manuscript authors is also very important. And if all these criteria is followed, then the probability of a good review by a new reviewer is 87% versus the 7% when the reviewer is unknown or is the unexperienced. So coming to the conclusion part of my presentation, tips for the reviewers, be courteous and constructive. Your role is advising, not deciding. Try to suggest improvement no matter what the outcome may be. Maintain the confidentiality. Do not review work for those who you know well. Complete review promptly, typically within 4 weeks. Spend at least 1 hour on the review. This is very important. Spend at least 1 hour because if you are spending less than 1 hour, then you are not reading that review properly. Search for the related work for this. Google is properly available where you can go and read lots of things and write as much as you would like to be written. Stand 1 hour related work and write. This comment that the reviewer is giving should be according to like he wants to his paper to be published. The way he wants to his paper to be written, the same way the comment should be there. So suggestion for the pattern peer review, make peer review part of the training with supervision, which we are discussing here. Hide the identifiers of the author and peer review with minimum of 3 reviewers. General should ask the editor should at least 3 reviewers where they can be decided. If there are 2 yes, can be accepted, 2 no, can be rejected. So there is no equal 1 yes, 1 no. The bias is removed. Have a quantitative and qualitative element that I showed you. Both sides of elements should be there, where they should be asked for their opinion, their comment, and as well as there should be a scoring system. Allow anyone to comment while the article is online. This is the latest trend which will be discussed by Dr. Kepke. Require reviewers to disclose absence of bias. Yes, very important. And show the author the full review on the request. And publish the peer review for every peer, accepted or rejected, online. So, at the end, I will advise the reviewers to go through the peer reviewer quick guides, which is available online and which has all the part from the citation to unclear recruitment, sample size, confidentiality, impartiality, reviewer manuscript management, approval statistical management, disclosure of the conflict, review quality, constructive criticism, objective, reporting of the stat significance, justification, distribution, and unclear research methods and using power analysis to determine the appropriate number of the subject. That is, this has both the quantitative as well as the qualitative elements. So in the end, I will say thank you very much for listening and sorry for the net glitches in between. Now I will hand over to Mrs. Nikita for further proceeding. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for very knowledgeable presentation of your. I would like to invite now Kethi, Dr. Kethi, for her presentation.
Yes. So, good evening to the very scholarly populace that is present with us for the workshop. After a very, very informative lecture of Dr. Lalit sir, now it's my turn to take you all further in this journey of peer review. I just hope you all enjoy the journey with us today. For this, I have firstly, incorporated the picture of a honeybee collecting the nectar from the flower, you know. So this picture or image, I have not just put it to increase aesthetics of my slide, but I really believe that these, they specify perfect models of what we are assigned to do as peer reviewers, just like the bees collect good quality nectar from whole of the flora that is available to them, we as reviewers also should have the knack to select good quality work. And just not to collect it, but modify it to more refined product, more workable study, more relevant study with lot of clinical utility. Overall, to construct a good research work, which is just not beneficial for the author or the publication or the journal, but it should of course be helpful for the entire healthcare sector of ours. Okay. So with this note, let us begin with our topic for today. And as we all know that peer review is nothing but expert feedback on the work that is being presented to him based upon his knowledge in that particular field. But I truly believe that, whenever a study is being presented to the expert peer, he just doesn't add his knowledge to it, but he also adds his own unique perspective to the study, his perspective based on his experience, which will not only add theoretical knowledge to the study, but also will tell us, how relevant is the study, how workable is it, how feasible it is, and etc. So I think that is extremely important for us as reviewers to do so. Now, talking about peers, man is a social animal, and we all being humans, peer opinions, social comments, peer comments, social pressures, these all have been an integral part of each one of us's personal as well as professional lives. And that is why, we all know that what impact does, negative comments, reinforcement of negative opinions by our peers have on a growth of an individual or a growth of a work altogether, okay? It definitely comes under the strata of criticism, and criticism always, yields in total discouragement, and it stunts the progress of any work, any project, or any individual. And similarly, positive criticism or positive opinions which reinforce the concept of self-improvement, the areas of self-improvement, comes under the strata of constructive criticism. It fosters the progress of any individual or product. So even in our research peer review, the model is, and it of course should be based on the theory, the basic theory of constructive criticism. Now, to have this constructive criticism theory in your review, I think the reviewer should have these four important behavioral traits. That whenever a research project comes to your table, first come first is that the reviewer should be in a state of open mind. His mind should not have certain presumed notions regarding the work that is being presented to him. Moreover, I think the reviewer, before reviewing the work, should make it his own work. As Lalit sir had already said, that whatever work you want to, your work you want to publish, similarly, you should take consideration of others' work also. Because ultimately, a lot of efforts have gone in that particular study by the author, and you as reviewer should respect it. Okay. Thirdly, I feel this is the job for which we are assigned. That is, healthy criticism. Sorry, there's some disturbance. Please mute yourselves, everyone, okay? So third point is healthy criticism, for which we are assigned. It is the positive critical analysis of the article, which will take that article to another level by, proper refinement that has to be done from experts' opinion. And fourth, I would like to say that, whatever is the result of our review, may it be rejection of that particular manuscript or acceptance of the work, you should always give an impact of positivity to the author. Your comment should always give encouragement of the to the author to keep going with his study and, to make the revisions as early as possible. Because ultimately, I think that we belong to the fortunate 15% of the, the researcher population around the globe. And hence, every one of us's perspective and opinion should be respected, because this actually reminds me of a story of an elephant and four blind men, Each one had grabbed some different part of the elephant, and they were arguing that the elephant is what the part is. So similarly, in our research stream also, it is not possible for any one of us to grab the whole stream. Hence, people having different expertise in different streams, different opinions and expertise, they all should come together to share their own perspectives and knowledge. In this way only, we all together can grow, and it will blossom the whole research field to its best, I think. Okay, having said that, this slide I have specially designed to, you know, give some context to the commentary that a reviewer should make, and also the slide also gives some word of caution. So first come first, how the comment should be. So I would like to say that our comments should be a reflection of the manuscript. Okay, it should reflect the strengths as well as weaknesses of the manuscript genuinely, because, you know, mirror or a reflection is always 100% genuine. So similarly, our comments also should reflect all the positives and negatives of the manuscript thoroughly. Secondly, I feel one should always keep it in mind that more to the point are the reviewer comments, the better they resonate with the author, and the authors are also in a much better position to understand what revisions are expected from them. Okay. Thirdly, I would like to say that whatever are your comments, you should always have a logical reasoning for why are you saying so. And this actually holds true in rejection process. You know, whenever you are rejecting a particular work or a manuscript, you should always have reasons for that. Because firstly, otherwise it won't give a proper, healthy impact to the author if you just reject their work like that. And secondly, it's a bit unprofessional on the reviewer's part also. Okay. While doing so, while, you know, especially giving rejections or criticism on a particular portion of the manuscript, it is mandatory for the reviewer to use a polite tone in their comments. Okay. So, because, you know, using a certain word which you shouldn't use or rude commentary, it won't just discourage the author, but the author will always reconsider your journal, you know, whether he should be giving the work to that particular journal or no. Okay, so that also hinders the scope of that journal altogether. And fifth, I think here lies the highest skill of a reviewer. Your comments should always have an equilibrium between criticizing the study and appreciating the author. So the words of criticism should always balance with words of praise. So it should be a right balance, because much of any of the particular trait will not serve the purpose. Okay. So after a critical analysis, however critical you have done the analysis, at least make sure that your comments end with some words of appreciation for the author. It will really create a very positive impact on the author. Because ultimately, you know, if we are the chosen experts from a particular field, so that expertise, power of expertise, lay on our shoulders a great responsibility for filtering out and modifying great discoveries by great people. Okay, so that is what I really mean to emphasize in this presentation. Because, you know, I think peer reviewing, although it is a very important job, but it is still a very underrated one. You know, it's such a complex job, but no particular catalog is being designed for peer reviewing. Now, even if we go to a local restaurant, the food that they serve on your table now also undergoes a critical quality check or quality control. So just imagine with the peer reviewers, whatever content they are filtering out, they are responsible for every aspect of it, you know. It's just not the quality of the content. They are also liable for its overall truthfulness, the ethical issues involved, its utility, its accountability and everything. So I think that is the complexity of peer reviewing. And secondly, I think peer reviewing is also not an overnight job that you are done with it. But peer reviewers have to carry on their review process whenever invited. Throughout all the days of a year, okay. So the consistent good quality review only fosters development of great researchers, and during such rainy days of pandemics and epidemics, it is only because of great peer reviewed treatment protocols and all that we are able to save so many lives. So I think that is the complexity of a peer reviewer job. Now, this was all about the theoretical aspect of peer reviewing, the theoretical principles on which a peer review should ideally be based on. Now, this flowchart actually explains us the more practical aspect of it, that although, yes, the peer review, yes, it should be fair, it should be, equal, etc. But nowadays, one peer reviewer should always have an aim that he is also providing his expert service to the publisher or the editor as well as the authors. So if we are chosen as peer reviewers for a particular topic from so many and millions and tons of researchers available today, so again comes a responsibility of delivering our expertise to the to its maximum quality. Okay. Secondly, the content, somebody's 5 years of content or 5 years of study is being given to you for reviewing. So privacy of that content is also your responsibility, and it is of utmost importance. Okay. Thirdly, I think today, as we all will agree on this point, that it is an era of competition. And everyone, right from the researchers to the publication houses, are modifying their techniques for betterment. And hence, even our review should, you know, instigate that point of healthy competition amongst every one of us. And finally, I feel that, yes, our review should provide an equal platform to the youngest of the researcher, to the, you know, the more established researchers. So, because it so happens, you know, that young researchers, although have quality content, but they have some hitch in sending their studies to the big names of the journals. So I think that it is our responsibility as reviewers to really help them out and provide an equal platform for everyone without any bias. Because ultimately, I feel that we all here are for a common reason, that is, we need to foster highest quality patient care and really help our healthcare system to grow for better. And hence, I think that all these multifaceted qualities are required to be a good reviewer, and hence not any Tom, Dick and Harry can become a reviewer. The person needs all these you know, behavioral traits in his start to become a good reviewer. Now we will come to the most important part of today's presentation, that is models of peer review. Now, these first four models are actually, we all are thorough with them. And next models I have put, which are, you know, which have evolved currently, discuss each of them individually. So first is a single blind peer review model, in which, you know, authors don't know who the reviewers are. Reviewers know the authors. Okay. So now, because the identity of reviewers is hidden, what happens? Reviewers are more, you know, frank in giving their opinions and outputs regarding a particular manuscript. And now, because the reviewers know who the authors are, so what they can do is they can go back, they can have a background idea on what kind of researches have been, you know, came from those authors, so that that would create a foundation on which the reviews can be based. Okay, and in this review model, you know, the very established and well-known researchers in the academia as well as good universities are highly benefited in this kind of model. Now, this model actually always reminds me of the ancient times, you know, wherein the emperors, what they used to do is they used to get disguised as local villagers, and then they used to have a troll from their kingdom. Okay, and what they used to do is they used to take feedback from all the local villagers about how the system of work is going on in that kingdom. Then they used to review that content which they have collected from various people of various strata, and then they used to construct the scope of improvement that they have to run their dynasty, you know, the essential modifications to be done, etc. So this used to work superbly when in our ancient times. But having said that, this model has a very big drawback of reviewer bias. Now, to explain this drawback, I think the example of Einstein fits the best. What has happened that Einstein, along with his colleague Mr. Rosen, they together had challenged the traditional model of gravitational force exists as wave. Okay. And to edit the very reputed journal of that time, you know, challenging the theory of waves. What had happened? That there was the reviewer for that journal, who was Mr. Robertson, who was Einstein's colleague from Princeton University. Now, this fellow knew that the work is from Einstein, and he was a very jealous kind of a fellow. So what he did on paper, and then what happened, Einstein had to withdraw that paper and had to submit it to some local periodical. Now, as I told you, privacy of the content is really important. That work was there with Mr. Rosen. Okay. So he made sure that, you know, Einstein gets challenged with his published work, and it caused Einstein a lot of public embarrassment also. Hence, Einstein had to change the paper title, and he just had to withdraw his theory of challenging theory of waves. He just wrote a simple article on gravitational waves. Until date, his novel theory of how the gravitational force actually is didn't come to light. So imagine if Einstein had to suffer such kind of bias when he was at his peak of his career, at because of this reviewer bias, so many Einsteins would suffer with this model. Hence, a more bias-free model was designed, which is double-blind peer review model. In this, neither author know who the reviewer is, nor reviewer know who the author is. Okay, so two-way blinded theory it is. So what is the advantage? I feel that whenever we form an opinion on just the content of the work or just a person, okay, without knowing the background tags, that from where the content has came, who is the researcher, what are his qualifications, etc. The opinions are more genuine, okay, and they are also more, you will have a more long lasting relationship with that particular content. So I think this theory works best, and hence it is the most popular theory among the healthcare journals. Even innovative publication journals also follow this double-blind peer review model. But again, double-blind peer review model was also not 100% bias-free, because the third and the main person involved, that is the editor, he knew both reviewers and the authors. Okay. So, and in many of the journals, editor has the final word of whether the article has to be accepted or rejected. So, editorial bias was a problem. Hence, triple blind peer review was designed, wherein all three of them, editor, reviewers, and authors, had to hide their identities. Okay. So, now as we all know that our Indian law system functions on this model, and the rejection or acceptance of the work is just based upon the content. The manuscript is being given, you know, a unique reference number, and is evaluated just based upon that number and nothing more to it. But then, you know, the model also has certain flaws in it, because nowadays editor, the name of the editors, etc., are being, you know, openly displayed on the websites and all. And sometimes it was also seen that, you know, based upon the type of comments or based upon the genre of writing, even to some extent, people could guess at who the reviewer is and who the author is. So 12% of error was still noted in a study which was done on this double blind peer review. So what all publication houses decided is that, let us chuck off all these, you know, hidden identity things. Let us have an open review system in which everyone is open for discussion. Each other without hiding anything. So that may foster a really constructive review. So I think this open review model is a bit of Taj Bahu model, in which there is open criticism but in a healthy way. Okay. Here some journals have started also following this open review model, and found that the reviewers were very civil with the authors. The authors were also very prompt with their revisions, and it kind of, you know, motivated reviewers, because, you know, it was a very good show for their expertise to all. And moreover, reviewers were getting a kind of recognition also. Okay. But again, it had a major problem of junior-senior bias. Now, if, for example, the work of some senior faculty comes to a junior person, junior was not in a position to really give his frank opinions regarding his senior's work. So this actually was the biggest problem with this model. Now, with ever evolving research field are the ever evolving models also. So here comes a new form of peer model, which is transferable peer review. This transferable peer review is really a good model of reviewing, I feel. Because, you know, here if you know, editor after peer reviewing, if he finds that particular manuscript does not have scope in his journal, what the editor will do, he will notify the author and he will transfer that manuscript to some similar journal but under the same publisher, okay, where that article may find its place. So what happens is, author is also properly guided regarding the scope of his manuscript. The manuscript also remains with the same family of publisher, and even that particular transferred journal gets more submissions. So I think this is a win-win model to, for everyone. And it is similar to, you know, if you are selling a chilled water bottle on a beach, maybe it won't have scope there, but if same bottle is sold on a desk, you will earn like anything. So it is similar to that. But then again, it has got some problem areas involved. Like, for example, the journal to which the work is being transferred, maybe that journal is write down the manuscript as per the publication standard of the journal, and they actually work together till that manuscript script reaches the publication standard. So this is the best possible model for, you know, gaining maximum guidance from the reviewers, and even reviewers amongst themselves can really have good networking and good discussions. So I think the model with maximum constructive output is a collaborative review model. But it again has negative points, such as, you know, always having independent opinions is beneficial for any kind of work, because you will have many more suggestions to come up for the author. And again, that line of demarcation between the expert and the expertise fades away. So, you know, that is to be considered in this kind of model. Next is the recent one, which is the model of post-publication review. Now, here, this model is based upon, you know, once the manuscript gets published, the review process doesn't end there. Okay, what the journal houses do, they keep a discussion page for that manuscript or a dialogue box in which people from various streams and experts, etc., they can review, they can have discussions over that manuscript, they can write down their opinions about that manuscript, etc., on that discussion box. So this is actually a model of evolving knowledge where consistent improvements on the work can be achieved. Okay. But this is not an independent model, because whenever you are publishing a manuscript, it has to undergo some quality check by some traditional models. This is just an add-on process which nowadays many journal houses are incorporating. And moreover, the biggest negative point with this model is, you know, one genre of scientific writing, which is, writing letters to editors, which is especially designed for critical analysis or having opinions on previously published good studies by good authors, that genre will, you know, ultimately lose its scope. So the model is still under review. So next, I think, is the transparent review model. It is actually an integrated program wherein, you know, whole of the peer review process is traceable, trackable from a single button click of your laptop, you know. You can view the entire peer review process. You will know at what step is your article, who is the peer reviewer, what are the comments of the reviewers, how the revisions are made, and everything on the publication portal. This kind of system also acts as a reference point for many of the young authors and researchers, you know, to actually know the review process, etc. So it is a bit of uncomfortable model for some reviewers, and there was a rejection rate when studied by DMC and DMJ of about 20%, because everything is very transparent. One cannot be honest at times about certain aspects of the manuscript. Hence, I know peer reviewing process is under debate many times. Many people agree with the process, with the reviewers, many people do not. Okay, but it is the most necessary process when it comes to filtering out the scientific literature, and it's just not important, it is mandatory also, because, you know, wherever you go, if you want permission for research funding, you want patents, even if you want basic permission for certain clinical trials, your only your work with proper peer review team, proper peer review journals will only have validity in our professional field. And I feel that peer reviewing is the field which will never extinct, and it will always progress and have lot of scope for all of us as peer reviewers. And hence, this is my favorite quote from Winston Churchill that, you know, may peer review not be everyone's cup of tea, but it functions just like pain in your body. It will tell you exactly where is the unhealthiness so that you can improve it for the better. Okay. So with this, I would like to say that we all should keep reading. We all should keep commenting, give opinions in our field. Because believe me, words do have a lot of power. So thank you all. Thanks a lot for your patient listening.
Presentation open here.
Yes.
Thank you, ma'am, for your nice presentation. I want to ask Rakesh Pandit to share his knowledge about and the light. Division and reviewing parts by
good evening. Welcome to InVelly Publication. Myself Rakesh Pandit, and today I am sharing my presentation with glimpse of our various peer review process, award function, and it's related to my topic. Few of our journals. It's a few of our list of journals which published by InVelly Publication. It's cover page and displaying here. In short, I would like to introduce innovative in a figure and its aesthetics, how innovative workings. We have currently 50 plus journals and 150 plus books published by InVelly Publication. Total number of article 23,000 plus article have published by from 2013 to till date at the InVelly Publication, and number of downloaded of articles 175,000 plus article downloaded by InVelly Publication websites, and our pre-publication rejection rate is 41% of the manuscript rejection rate. These are the usage aesthetics of the InVelly Publication. Now, research associates currently on regularly basis 20,000 to 25,000 hits researchers, scholars, doctors, and academicians visit our website for downloading the research papers, articles, etc. 4,500 editorial board members are associated with us for 50 journals, and 3,500 reviewers are regularly reviewing our research papers as a innovative reviewer board. 25,000 researchers, academicians, and doctors are publishing regular articles on InVelly Publication, and 400 plus authors are associated as a publication of medical, dental, nursing, pharmacy, books, and journals. These are the academician panels of InVelly Publication. Why innovative? There are few reasons why to choose InVelly Publication. Three point is that InVelly provides technical assistance and ethical guidelines. First, InVelly is the India leading and emerging publishers in publication of medical, dental, nursing, pharmacy, and allied science journals. A stagnant and transparent policy, timely and regular publication of the research contents, peer review process, technical assistance. InVelly pre-publication portal has hassle-free, smooth editorial process of the manuscript, following all ethical policies and of the publication, all assistance of academic organizations, ethical guidelines. Innovative publication highly recommend ethical guidelines of the international publication ethics and publishing styles. Innovative is the members of various international publishing policy like POPE, ICMJE, UMA, NISO, CSE, CROSREF, DOAJ, and etc. Innovative serves for authors, researchers, academicians, societies, and libraries. Nearly, as I explained earlier, 25,000 researchers and academicians are associated with the innovative panel as the authors, 25,000 researchers and academicians. More than 10 plus societies are associated with us as a society members, like societies like ISRF, Khyati Education and Research Foundation, Santosh University, Telangana Journal of Psychiatry, PJM Panacea Journal of Medical Science, JETS, and many more. We innovative survey more than 1,000 libraries across the globe, national globe. Major clients are in medical, dental, nursing, pharmacy, colleges, and hospitals are subscribing and procuring the books of the innovative publication on a regularly basis. These are peer review process of the innovative publication cycles. This is a very interesting topic for the everyone knows what is the publication cycle of the articles. So these are the publication cycle of the article. Author submit the manuscript to the editorial office as per journal guidelines. After submission of the article, allotment of the manuscript number with acknowledgement and automated mail and message reached to author for their ready reference. After allotment of the reference, editorial office start working of the editorial scrutiny. After completion of the editorial scrutiny, manuscript to be sent to peer reviewer by executive editor in chief along with the critical appraisal pro forma. Peer reviewer comments, if peer reviewer comments sent to the authors by the editor for the compliance. Corrected manuscript sent by the author will undergo editorial scrutiny. Letter of acceptance or rejection to be communicated to the author. After that, selection of the article and submission of the final submission of the copyright and research any documents, research copyright form. After submission of the copyright form, we give acceptance letter of the respective corresponding author. After signing of the corresponding acceptance letter, article goes to ahead of print of the respective journals for the referencing and citation purpose. After ahead of print, journals published for the scheduled date and time galley proof of the article to the sent to the corresponding author, print proof of the journal to be reviewed by editorial team, then online publication of the manuscript. After 20 days of the online publication, we process for the final publication of the print. If there is any possibility for correction and updation, we can change. After print final publication, post publication work start, indexing, dispatching of the journals, sending of the author certificate and hard copy of the journals, and circulation of the journals is in the library. Journals peer review process, I think already Dr. Lalit and Dr. Ketki has already explained about very better way, and rest part they will continue by tomorrow. Reviewer award systems. Innovative, this very important and important for the reviewers who is interested to join innovative publication as a reviewer. Academic value and knowledge. Establish your expertise in the field of expand your knowledge. You will be aware of the latest method and trends in the area of expertise. You can improve your editing and writing skill, master new style of writing. Peer-reviewed journal articles are the major deliverable of scientific research, and they are necessary to progress in one's career and demonstrate that your future research is worth funding. Innovative reviewer rewards. Free access of all innovative journals. This will gives you access to content for all the archives volume, presence of the more than 50 journals across the medical, dental, nursing, pharmacy fields, including new upcoming issue during the coming future, as well archive issue. Reviewer certificate at the end of the year, 25% discount on in all innovative books published for the reviewer. Display of reviewer name on the website of the specific specific journals cover page, back side of the every year, and his on the website. Discount on the APC, article processing charges, chance to promote as a editorial board member of the journals, reviewer award and nomination rights, reviewers thanks week. Innovative organize reviewer thanks week every year, and we highlight the all best reviewers who have reviewed the given best effort for the review and quality improvement of the quality of the articles. Reviewer facilitation platform. Innovative pre-publication portal provide services for the reviewers. Now, reviewer certificates. Innovative publication provide three category of the affiliation for the benefit for the reviewers. First is the who have reviewed 15 plus articles, they get first category. 15 plus category, we give A plus category for reviewers. Who review 5 to 14 articles, they are eligible for A category. And who review 0 to 4 articles in a year, those are eligible for B category. Innovative pre-publication portal is a platform where registered as a reviewer and being as a editorial part of the journals. Everywhere we give best author award, best reviewer awards, and memento with the certificate. Annual conference reviewer award. Innovative organize every year annual conferences for the reviewer awards, who is there proactively reviewing the articles with respective editor-in-chief, editorial board members, and publishing house. Global reach of the innovative publication. You can see and identify the global reach of the innovative global reach. Head office in India, New Delhi. Virtual office USA, UK, and Singapore. Branch offices Kolkata, Bangalore, Ujjain in Madhya Pradesh, Nagpur. Abroad offices Nigeria and Ethiopia. Recently, we are planning to move for more offices across the country. Distribution, we have 90 plus subscription agent globally who is proactively participating and selling the books, journals, all in all medical colleges, dental colleges, nursing and pharmacy colleges and hospitals. We have 40 plus booksellers and suppliers which are supplying books and journals, global content and alliance. JGATE, EBSCO and ProQuest is the global content alliance partner of the innovative database and content. Apart from that, innovative books and journals books are available on Amazon, Flipkart and many more commercial websites. Milestone of the innovative publication. Innovative publication, all journals are indexed from 2014 to till with Index Copernicus as per recommended by Medical Council of India, Dental Council of India and other index, other research organization in global and India. CrossRef, we are the member of CrossRef from 2015 to till Google Scholar, JGATE, DROID, Directory of Openly Access Resources, PKP, Public Knowledge Projects, NESCIAR, Indian Science Life Abstract, DOAJ. Thanks. Thank you. Please visit innovativepublication.com or write us info@ipinnovative.com for any query. Thank you.
I have tried to answer many of the questions, but few are the left which Dr. Kethki and me can answer with the help of Mr. Rakesh. Okay. Dr. Kethki, there's a question for you.
Yes, sir.
Qualitative review again was not audible. Please. Okay.
Hello, sir. Am I audible?
Yeah, yes. Everyone is okay.
Yes, ma'am.
So the questions are, when the journal collects APJ, why not some honorarium may be paid to the reviewers? Yeah. As I just told you by Mr. Rakesh, there is a policy of every journal and we have the general policy of giving the certificates and the discount and not directly paying the honorarium, but we have the lots of things. And similarity index and plagiarism, this all has been discussed in the previous session as the innovative publication, which has the more weightage. First author in the non-index journal, last author in the index journal, it is a very different person to person. While I will say that the last of the index journal is always a preferred one. However, for the beginners, even a non-index journal is a good platform because it sharpens their writing skills. And what are the UGC approved journals for this? This can be downloaded from the UGC side. Okay, what is the difference between open review and transparent review? Dr. Kethki can answer it.
So which is the question? May I get it?
The difference between the open peer and the transparent peer reviewer. They want to know about the open and the transparent peer reviewer.
Yes. So, open peer review system, in open, someone probably has got the idea or the access. Means what they do, they publish the article along with the comments of the reviewers. So that even the audience can view what the reviewer comments are. Along with the authors, and this is about open peer review system. When the article gets published, along with the reviewer comments, name of the reviewers, or many a time reviewers have to sign on their the form that they submit for after a review. So that identity will be known, and even what comments are made will be known. Whereas in transparent peer review system, it is actually through a software nowadays wherein you can track each step. You know, it's just not about reviewer comments. It is also about where the article is, has it passed the first editorial review process, then first reviewer, second reviewer, then revisions by the author and everything. It is a total complete roadmap which is being trackable from your devices. That's actually through software, which many publication houses are incorporating. Lalit sir, if you want to add something, please do it.
More than sufficient what you have just told. Okay, there is another questions. Let's see. Okay, I think more of the relevant questions have been answered and the timing is now complete. So may I request Mrs. Nikita to wind up the session?
I have seen here. So now I would like to conclude this thing. It is very fantastic presentation by
How publisher are required to become an university applied? I have a request. How Dr. Ranjit Kumar, he has written how the publication can require to become a reviewer. So for become a reviewer, you have to visit our website, innovativepublication.com, and there is a panel of innovative pre-publication portal. Log in as a reviewer and select your as a reviewer as per your specialty journals. And then we will give you the acceptance letter for the join as a reviewer. After that, we will send the article for the further review process.
If Rakesh sir, you are done, I would like to just make an announcement to all the participants that, just try the assignments that are being, displayed on the website. Nikita ma'am have already announced them beforehand. Just go and have an experience of hands-on on those assignments, and it would be evaluated by the expert people like Gupta sir. So you would definitely benefited, and even exciting rewards and prizes are also kept. So I would request all of you to download your assignment templates and upload it to the site as soon as possible. Thank you.
It is presented on the innovpub.org. So you all are requested to go through the www.innovpub.org and download the research article for the review process and upload in the same portal there. The procedure should be mentioned there as well. So now I would like to thank all of the participants who are attending from India, from abroad, from lots of participants are attending here, and live session also is attended by a number of participants. So I would thank you all, and I thank Dr. Lalit Gupta for his very interesting and knowledgeable presentation on the peer review. I thank Dr. Kethi for knowledge sharing on the interesting subject. And I think Rakesh also for explaining about peer review procedure and incentives from innovative publications, what we provided. And I have an announcement for tomorrow. Tomorrow we have a session again with Dr. Bhavna Gupta and Dr. Rajesh Singh on the topic ethics in peer review and incentive motivation and recognition in peer review by the Dr. Rajesh Kumar Singh from Pablon Academy Mentor. He is a mentor in Pablon Academy. So we will get lots of knowledge from them also tomorrow. So for today, I would like to say good night to all of you. Thank you for joining us.
Thank you, everyone.
Thank you
for the support.
Dr. Lalit sir, Dr. Kirti ma'am, Nikita madam. It's nice. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you all. Thank you so much for giving me an opportunity. Thank you.
Thank you. Thanks all participants who have given their valuable times. Thanks to all.
After event, you had all automatically generated in feedback form. So in that feedback form, also that assignment link are available there. So just fill the feedback form and revert us back. Thank you. Looking to meet you tomorrow.